All right, everybody, we're going to get started with our next speaker. I have the pleasure of introducing our next speaker, a colleague of mine, Spencer Brown. Spencer founded his Young Americans for Freedom chapter at Regent University in 2012, and he's been involved with Young America's Foundation ever since. In addition to activism and conferences, he's an alumnus of YAF's National Journalism Center. His experience as a student led him to his position at the foundation today, where he helps young conservatives across the nation when their schools infringe students' First Amendment rights. Spencer joined the headquarters team in 2015 and now serves as Spokesman. He frequently appears on Fox News, has been quoted in national outlets, and contributes to The Federalist and Town Hall, among others. Please join me in welcoming Spencer Brown.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. You are in for a special treat today because this is actually the first time I've given this specific presentation, and it's a little bit different than what I usually talk about. So as Bree mentioned, in my work, normally I'm talking about what is going on in the media when it sort of pertains to college campuses and what's going on there. So obviously we know most of the mainstream media tends to be pretty biased, but that is especially true when it comes to college campuses because the media wants to deny that all of you exist. And so we've seen that transition down even to high schools where they just don't like the idea that there are all these young conservatives who are at their high schools working to make sure their peers hear conservative ideas, whether it's in the classroom or through their activism. This speech is going to be talking a little bit more about how the media covers the free market and the people who are running our economy, the people who actually sort of keep things running, versus how it talks about things like socialism, how it talks about these leftist leaders who have become very profitable and very powerful thanks to the free market, but then turn around and use that power in order to kind of just trash the system that gave them what they got. So to get started, YAF did a poll just recently. Raj and Carl helped me with this, but we did a poll last summer to see what Generation Z actually thinks about the ideas of socialism versus the free market. Because you see all the time in the media, supposedly your generation, Gen Z, the rising generation, is just in love with socialism. Everybody wants socialism, that's all you want. And I'm guessing by a show of hands, nobody here would raise their hands and say they want socialism, something that we knew. So we wanted to get the data behind it. And so even though a lot of young people say we love socialism, more than half of them can't even define what socialism is. We actually asked them in an open-ended question, what does socialism mean? And they said things like free stuff, socializing, you know, hanging out with your friends. They don't understand what socialism is, but they've been taught that this buzzword socialism is a good thing. And so we wanted to get to the bottom of where did that come from? Why do people think socialism is so great when we know in reality it is a disastrous system? And what we found is sort of a multifaceted thing that the left has done, where through education they tell you what to think, and that is that socialism is good, but they don't tell you how to think and how to evaluate different economic systems. A lot of the speakers you've heard this weekend have gone through all the reasons why socialism doesn't work. It is a net drain on people's lives. It makes people unhappy. It literally kills people. But then that sort of educational part of this is combined with what you see every day. So what you see in pop culture, what you see in the media especially. And so that's what we're gonna dive into now. So this is actually based on a speech. If you've ever been to a YAF conference before, you may have heard this a different way. YAF's president, Ron Robinson, put together covers of Time Magazine and Newsweek Magazine to see how the media covers conservatives. And so we kind of narrowed that down to look at how they talk about business leaders, economic systems. And so let's get started. This is the first one. Everybody loves Bernie, right? Time Magazine gives us this smiling grandfatherly figure. Subtitle is Socialize This America. Obviously doesn't talk about all the negative things that Bernie Sanders' policies would bring forward, all the damage his ideas have done to the country and would do if they were fully implemented. Everybody's exactly, this is basically the figurehead for what the left has made out to be young people loving socialism. You know, she's this bartender from Brooklyn who became a member of Congress, unseated this older sort of long-term incumbent in New York, and became sort of the face of the squad, the face of socialism and its popularity among young people. But again, her ideas would completely destroy even the industry she came from. You know, minimum wage laws, all these regulations would hurt bartenders, and she doesn't even understand that where she came from, she should be wanting to help people in those positions, and instead, she's taken all the popularity the media can give her by saying literally crazy things. Then, if you think this is a current thing, you would be wrong. This is a Time Magazine cover, obviously from quite a while ago, with Fidel Castro. We've heard a lot of stories about what is wrong with Castro's regime. You know, this is a murderous regime who completely stripped freedom from his people, and just, you know, if you weren't in power, you had nothing. If you were one of his friends, then life was pretty great for you, but ultimately it was a disaster. But Time magazine, even back then, talks about how he's making a desperate attempt to get business, and they have an exclusive conversation with him. They're propping him up as somebody sort of trying to help his people, when obviously the plight of his people is directly his own fault. Goes back even farther. Stalin, responsible for the death of, depending on who you ask, around 20 million people. But again, Time magazine, he's got sort of this forward look in his eye. He looks like he's, you know, really dreaming for the future. You can see the Soviet star streaking across the sky in the background, propping up these people as if they're somebody, you know, idealistic, when really all they're doing is trying to maintain power for themselves at the cost of human lives, of their country's future. But again, Time magazine doesn't have a problem putting them on the front of their magazine. Then Che Guevara, how many of you have seen your friends on the left wearing Che Guevara t-shirts? Is that still a thing?
No?
That's good. That's very good. Somebody has it. Okay. So Che Guevara, their t-shirts used to be much more of a thing. Thankfully, it's kind of not as in style anymore. But if you remember, when President Obama visited Cuba for a diplomatic trip, I guess now that would be probably 5 or 6 years ago, he posed and did a press conference in front of a giant mural of Che Guevara there. And this is somebody the left will have you believe is this peaceful sort of hippie who rode his motorcycle around South America talking about the importance of workers' rights. In fact, he was basically a domestic terrorist who went around killing people. YAF actually started an activism project called No More Che Day every year on the anniversary of death that kind of reminds students that this is not somebody to be idolized. But again, Time magazine gives him this sort of smirky look, as if he is somehow not a terrorist, which in fact he was. Then, a little bit more currently, you probably recognize the woman on the left specifically. That is Senator Elizabeth Warren. What a lot of people don't know, she talked about it a little bit in the debates, but she created more bureaucracy, which, as you heard from some of our speakers, just does nothing to help the economy, but it's called the CFPB, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. And she did that basically because she, again, believed we need more government involved in our lives in order to keep us safe, because who are we as the American people to be able to make good choices and invest and buy products that we know are good? She thought the government should have a hand in that. But again, here we have them portrayed as these sort of the law enforcement, the women charged with cleaning up the mess, when in fact groups like the CFPB actually make more of a mess out of our economy, make it harder to prosper, and just bring more big government into our everyday lives. This Time Person of the Year, 1 year they named it as the protester. They have a couple, but to draw your attention, I don't know if you can see it in the back, but they list the Occupy Wall Street protesters as one of their sort of Person of the Year people to be idolized and again sort of remembered as these great examples. Occupy Wall Street happened, does anybody remember Occupy Wall Street? This happened, you were probably all in elementary school or kindergarten when this happened, but this was protests that took place. They started in New York, spread a little bit farther around the country, but the idea was, as we heard a lot this weekend, this idea of income inequality, this idea that some people make more and have more, is just this grave social injustice. And so these protesters literally set up in a park in New York City and just camped there for months. But the left thinks that that is a fine thing to do, and Time magazine was more than happy to give them credit for it. Warren Buffett, everybody's probably heard of him at some point in class if you've learned anything about sort of the richest people in America. Time magazine portrays him as the optimist, this sunshine kind of happy guy, but he continually uses his power and his platform to trash the free market, to say we need higher taxes, to say we need to have more government involvement. But again, for Time, that's an optimistic view to have, when in fact, as all of our speakers said this weekend, there's nothing optimistic when your goal is to just have more government in your life. Sort of blunt in this one, we're all socialists now. The perils and promise of the new era of big government, as if that's something good. I think from who you've heard already this weekend, you've learned of the dangers both financially and just to your personal happiness and life and safety. Big government is not something that you want to have around. But Newsweek has decided to just proclaim we're all socialists now. Here we go, Al Gore. You guys probably missed out on a lot of sort of Al Gore's greatest hits as they happened. But back when I was in high school, Al Gore was sort of this guy. He had the movie that came out about global warming. He was on all the TV shows. He was doing all this stuff. He's described by Newsweek as the thinking man's thinking man, which is silly, in my opinion, because everything that he was saying was basically the climate alarmism that's already been disproven since that movie came out. And yet here we have Newsweek propping him up. And again,
That is one of the ways that the left has continually tried to implement sort of their big government strategy in the economy, and we saw that through the Green New Deal, which I believe is the next thing coming up. Our sinking planet, this is the left's other favorite thing to do when it comes to media bias and the ways that they attack the free market and entrepreneurship and things. This guy, it even admits it in the caption, is standing off the coast of a country. But again, they make it sound like this is gonna be you next week when you wake up if we don't completely change the economy, regulate everything out of business. They think you're gonna be walking to work in a suit up to your knees in water because of rising sea levels. Going back to Al Gore again, YAF has a great booklet actually that one of my colleagues has put together that basically goes through since the 70s all of the false claims of climate alarmism that the left has made. By now, I believe Florida was supposed to be an island, basically Orlando, New York City, Manhattan was supposed to be underwater, we were supposed to be uninhabitable, we were supposed to have run out of oil, all this stuff. They keep pushing it on the cover of Time magazine. It never comes true, but it gets people scared enough that they're willing to hand control over to government in order to try to save themselves from having these kind of soggy commutes, apparently. Then this one, you all should know, Greta Thunberg, sort of one of your peers, really. As she points out, she should be in school. She should not be running around the world on a boat as her preferred form of transportation. But this is somebody who the left has just, the media especially, has just absolutely run with and set her up sort of as one of the most powerful people in the world fighting climate change. Again, all of those predictions have continually failed to come true. But this is somebody that the media has just decided is this brave hero for them, without even, you know, checking any of the things that she's saying, without really doing any work to see what her policies would do. You know, she keeps talking, combined with AOC, I guess, they want to get rid of everything from cows to cars to everything that basically makes our lives good and easy and worth living. They would rather just regulate it or ban it in order to save the planet from something that has yet to be shown as actually a threat. This one, again, Time. This magazine cover, I believe, is from 2006. So a little bit more recent, but just to show that going back, even when I was in middle school, they were saying the polar bears will all be dead, Earth is at a tipping point, it threatens your health. And interestingly, one of the things that I want to make a point on here as we transition from looking at some of the issues that the media will prop up in their push for big government and sort of socialist ideas, they say how China can help save the world. And that's something that we have seen now continually. So here we have Time magazine cover where they say, can China save the world? It's not a mirage. China's economic growth is astonishing. Still keep the champagne on ice. So in this way, they're saying don't quite celebrate yet, but China could save the world. This one, a little bit more blunt, China won, talking about trade wars. So again, they just continually prop up these governments that are no friend to the United States, are no friend to their own people even, and are certainly no friend to freedom. Here we have a very interesting cover from Time, Let's Be Friends. This is talking about China's relationship with Hong Kong. Obviously, this is sort of a long-running conflict, but recently we saw China, you know, basically run over Hong Kong and say you no longer have the same freedom that had made them such a good ally to the United States. We saw those brave freedom fighters in the streets kind of demanding that they be able to maintain their rights. But Time is making this sound like China is doing the bigger man thing and is reaching out to Hong Kong to try to keep a relationship going. Of course, then we have this, the Umbrella Revolution, Hong Kong's fight for freedom is a challenge to China. Again, they're taking everything from China's point of view. They're not looking at this through the eyes of the freedom fighters, which is just another way the media, through its framing bias, continues to attack conservatives and basically try to make our side seem like the losing side even from the start. Were any of you alive during the Bush administration? Probably just the tail end. But as you all probably remember, when President Trump was pursuing tax cuts, the left lost their minds in the media. They were talking about how this is the most financially irresponsible thing to do. Here is when President George W. Bush was pushing for tax cuts back in 2001. They obviously cartoonize him as just forking over hundreds of dollars of bills to people and then calling it a $1.6 trillion gamble. Again, as you've all learned this weekend, hopefully, giving people more of what they earn and trusting the American people to make the best choices with their money is the right thing to do. But Newsweek was definitely not happy to portray it in any sort of positive light of what it could do for the American people. Uncle Scrooge, Newt Gingrich, this, you can hardly tell that's Newt Gingrich, but that is Newt Gingrich, the former Speaker of the House. And for his contract with America to pursue, again, these pro-freedom, pro-growth economic policies, they portray him as Uncle Scrooge and say, "'Tis the season to bash the poor," which is an argument I'm guessing you all hear in your classes and just in your conversations with maybe your leftist peers, which is the idea that conservatives hate the poor, we're okay with income inequality, we must hate the poor. That's something that's been an argument of the left for decades. This one, Time Magazine, about capitalism. You can see, if you can't, in the middle there, it says, "The markets are choking our economy," which is, I think, an idea that's been pretty well refuted by all of our speakers this weekend. I'm not a doctor, I'm not an economist, but even I know that's not how that works. The free market is what actually keeps our economy running, and we should do everything we can in order to keep it as free as possible. If you look at this, this is Margaret Thatcher, believe it or not, that Time has chosen to portray as a factory, which I don't think that passes. I don't think the left would be okay with us depicting a liberal woman as a factory, but here, in any case, they have her embattled Britain, and her hair is apparently smoke coming out of chimneys. This one, corporate killers, Wall Street loves layoffs. So again, they take and they demonize the people who have the most and who are creating jobs because of the leftist economic policy that forces them to not hire as many people or to potentially lay people off. But of course, they don't put that part in the story, right? They completely, through sort of selection bias and confirmation bias, they just call these people evil for firing employees, but it is obviously the leftist policies that cause them to have to do that. We heard a lot from a couple different speakers about why the minimum wage actually hurts the people that it claims to help, and it's the same thing here. But then, of course, they need a scapegoat because they can never blame their own policies that bring in more government and hurt the economy. They have to blame someone, so they blame the people who created the jobs in the first place and tried to give people an opportunity to work and earn money. And Newsweek, back in the day, was more than happy to buy into that as well. Then, moving on a little bit more recently, this is from back in 2016. Donald Trump, of course, has the book, The Art of the Deal, but Newsweek was talking about all of his business flops and trying to explain them, which again, if you have heard any entrepreneurs talk, there are so many times where their first idea is not the idea that works. They have to continue sort of going back to the drawing board, figuring out how best to serve people through the free market. And so the fact that he flopped but then continued going is more of a testament, I think, to the way the free market allows entrepreneurs to take risks and eventually reward it, which obviously he has found a reward that most people would not find necessarily. Then we have all of the coverage of Time. Trump's cabinet is dismantling government as we know it. How many of you have been in a government class where they've talked about how the president is like just destroying our government from the inside? Yeah? Okay. So that argument is based on the false claim that by removing regulations and getting rid of all these superfluous regulations and everything is somehow destroying our economy. But as you learned this weekend, getting rid of those regulations that aren't necessary, that only kill jobs, only limit innovation, only slow things down, shouldn't be there in the first place. So because the president has gone after and gotten rid of all these regulations, the left's line on this and Time Magazine's line on this is that he's dismantling and destroying our government like a wrecking ball, even though the ultimate response to that, as we've seen before COVID hit, was a complete opening of the economy, more people working than ever before, people who had struggled with historically chronic high unemployment were going back to work. But of course, the media is never going to highlight those stories. As we see here, this was a series of Time covers where they did meltdown, total meltdown, and then year one is his hair on fire. Of course, at the same time they're printing these covers, like I mentioned, people are going back to work, the economy is reopening, jobs are coming back to the United States because of these free market policies, but Time Magazine was never going to emphasize that. They're just going to continue to have him melting and apparently with his hair on fire. This one, very interesting to me, the Great American Downgrade. They blame this on the Tea Party, which if you remember in 2010, the Tea Party happened during the Obama administration. They're looking at the debt crisis that we had back then when our debt was downgraded or our credit was downgraded in the world. But again, they blame it on the Tea Party, which was not in power. They were just a group of conservatives who came in and said, taxes are too high, we need to cut this stuff. They blamed it on the Tea Party instead of President Obama, who was the one enacting all these regulations that we've since tried to get rid of. And lastly, the left behind economy. I picked this one based on what Dr. Bradley was talking about, again, with this idea that minimum wage hurts the people that it actually claims to help. The left will run around and the media will run around and talk about all these people who are supposedly losing their jobs because there's not enough government in there to help them. But obviously, it's the heavy and ineffective hand of government that is causing the problems in the first place. And so again, the media here, Time, is just, instead of telling the stories of people who have the freedom and the opportunity to pursue what they want to do, they're just talking about them as if they've been left behind, when really less government would give them more opportunities to get sort of caught up again. So if we can return to what we started with, more than half of people, Gen Z students, so that's high school and college, Gen Z, can't describe the term socialism. Part of that, like I said, is because of the educational gap. The other part is because of all this stuff we see in the media. If you pick up a magazine, if you turn on CNN, if you turn on MSNBC, if you turn on NBC, ABC, or CBS, you're only going to hear these stories about how we need the government to help people, we need the government to have a larger role in our lives, when in fact that is not the case. As you've heard from all of our speakers this weekend, we need more freedom, and that in turn leads to more opportunity. So the question then, after you've been here this weekend, after you see sort of part of the bias that goes into why so many people claim to love socialism, even though they can't even define it, the question is, what do we do? And one of the other problems we found through this poll is the fact that 46% of people in your generation, your age range, report self-censoring in the classroom. So that means they have not shared an idea. They've not spoken up to refute what the leftist argument is. They've not sort of said, well, actually, my dad or my mom has a job in a small business and the government gets in the way of this. And they did it mostly because they're afraid of how their peers will react, which was interesting to us. We thought the fear would be mostly based on having their grades docked by their teachers, or having, you know, just sort of the social ostracization from their professor or their teacher, but in fact it was from their peers. And so this is why it's so important for you all to be here getting these arguments, but then not just learning here, but taking it back to your classroom. And what we found also through the poll is that when we took people who didn't know what socialism was and defined it for them, they actually then felt less favorably towards socialism, which tells us socialism is not actually appealing to young people. And why would it be? You know, it's this message of, you can't do anything on your own, you need government to do it. We know young people just in general are independent and want to have a chance to take risks and learn things and do different things. And so the good news of this then is that you can change minds, because young people, once they hear about socialism, they don't like it as much. And so that's your chance to step in with the opportunity to talk about why the free market is great, why economic freedom in general is good for people's health and happiness. And then we did a more recent poll, sort of to frame this up in a different way, where we looked at high school and college students and how they feel about patriotism. So we did this with townhall.com. It was called the Youth Patriotism Index. And we asked a number of questions. One of them, is America an exceptional and unique country? And you can see in the blue, that's high school students in Gen Z, and the green is college students. And do you see the gap there? Two-thirds of you, if you're in high school, believe America is exceptional. Less than half if you're in college. Then you look at the negative feelings, saying no, America is not exceptional, and the number of college students is way higher than that of high school students. And so what that tells us is college just erodes these patriotic feelings. It gets rid of this pride people have in their country. Obviously, yeah, we know why that is. But what this means is you have such a huge audience of people who probably believe similar things to you, but are just afraid to speak up. And so if you can talk to them and show them that they're not alone, you have all these allies naturally in your classroom.
And it's so important that you reach them while they're in high school, because once they get to college, you have a way steeper battle to fight in order to get them over to our way of thinking. Another question, are you proud of America? We see the same gap, 63 to 40, 16 to 32. And lastly, your view of American history. Even that, you see in college, fewer than half then are favorable on America's history, and that's just insane. America has a great history worth being proud of. And so that is why here at YAF, we believe that the future of America is up to you. So as I showed you with the media, as you see in your educational process, this is an asymmetrical battle. You are sometimes feeling like you're just one student in your classroom who has the power to speak up. But the important thing to realize is your voices are more powerful than all of the media, all of the professors, because you talk to your peers in a way that they understand. They listen to you differently than they listen to their parents or to their teachers or even to their pastors or other people in their community. And so that's why it's so important that you stay bold and you speak up and remember that YAF always has your back. You haven't heard her speak this weekend, but if you come to another program, you will. My colleague, Kara Zupkes, she works every single day to take your stories and make sure that they are exposed, because professors and teachers in high school get away with this stuff all the time. But YAF will always have your back, and we never back down from a fight. And that's why you shouldn't either. I think Bree has a microphone. I'm happy to take any questions you have about any of this. Thank you so much.
Let's keep it going for Spencer Brown. As usual, students, if you have any questions, please line up on the X's provided here.
My name is Heidi Scholler, and I'm from Lake Forest High School. As we know, the media is extremely biased. I just wondered what advice you had based on getting criticism from teachers and how high school students can voice their opinions and conservative beliefs.
Yeah, so high school classrooms are very different than college campuses. So YAF has sued a number of schools, and we beat UC Berkeley, we beat the University of Florida over situations where conservatives were not being treated equally as liberal students. High school, it's a lot sort of higher threshold you have to hit in order to have grounds for a lawsuit, because in high school, the teachers and the administrators are kind of acting in the place of parents, which is why Kara and I, my colleague and I, we find it so effective to just expose these situations. We've worked with Lisa a lot on situations that happened at her school and a lot of high schools, because we continue to see that once you put some sunlight on a situation, schools shrink back very quickly, because a lot of these communities are very patriotic communities, and when other people find out, other parents find out, people in the community realize what's going on, people start calling the school and saying, this isn't right, you need to make this right. One of my favorite quotes is President Reagan's, obviously a President Reagan quote would be my favorite one, but is the idea that if you can't make them see the light, make them feel the heat. And that's basically what we do every day, and what I mean when I say we have your back, because a lot of times students can go to their school administration and say, hey, I think this is wrong because I'm being treated differently just because of my viewpoint, and the school won't do anything because it's just a student. They're like, oh, whatever, it's a student. But when we step in, and all of a sudden it's, you know, a new story in the community, and then a new story in the state, and sometimes a new story in the country, that heat is what it takes to actually make them correct their errors and treat everybody equally.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Sorry. Hello, I'm Nicholas DiCarlo from St. Anselm's, and I was just wondering, you said that America has a good history. When I go back and say that to my peers, they'll always say, what about the Jim Crow and slavery laws? And I'm just wondering how to defend my point that America has a good history.
Well, right, and so that's one of the interesting things. The left, when you talk about history with the left, they think that when you say America has a history worth being proud of, they think, basically make that out to be you approve of everything that's happened in our history. But the fact that in just, you know, a couple hundred years, we have gone from a place where our people here were colonists, subjects of the crown back in England, to a place where we are the most free, most exceptional country in the world, that shows the genius of both our founders and kind of everybody along the way who's helped us make that progress. So the left will often say, I mean, right now it's happening here in Washington, D.C., where they're trying to tear down statues of Abraham Lincoln. They're trying to remove the mayor in D.C. had a working group. I don't know if you guys saw this story, but the working group recommended that the Washington Monument, the Jefferson Memorial, and a statue to Ben Franklin be removed or relocated. And it's all in this just insane vein that somehow what happened in the past has to be completely erased because somehow they're uncomfortable with it. It was the system of government that was created by those men that allowed America to make this progress and defeat the Nazis, defeat all of this evil around the world, defeat communism, and to think that that's not something worth being proud of is just insane. So again, just make them kind of define their terms, and anytime somebody's gonna say that to you, you know, ask them then, okay, do you support X, Y, and Z? So find out what their argument is that they're coming from, because they're also not saying that either. They're just saying that to try to shut you up.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
This will be our last question.
Hey, Spencer. Question from the online audience. So you talked about that the media has a lot of bias. Why do you think that the anti-capitalist bias is so prevalent in the media?
Oh, that's a great question. My predecessor, Emily Jashinsky, who's now the culture editor at The Federalist, actually has done a talk about this to a number of our conferences. But when you look at where these media organizations are based, you know, most of them are in New York, D.C., or Los Angeles. They all have bureaus out there. And if you look at the people who work in those few buildings where all the news comes out of, they are all basically from the same background. They all went to Ivy League schools in the same sort of Northeast corridor. They all have the very same experience of going to a leftist school, generally being liberal. And so when you have just that exact same way of thinking, it's basically like a college campus on steroids, because not only do they all think alike and believe the same thing, but they have a megaphone that reaches the entire country. And so when you go through 4 years of college at some elite Northeast school, no offense, Raj, Raj is the exception to the rule. He came out of there still thinking for himself and actually believing in freedom. But typically you come out of that believing just the exact same thing, and then that determines kind of how I talked about the selection bias and the confirmation bias, but that determines the stories you cover, how you cover them, the people you talk to, and it just gives you this completely one-sided story where instead of talking about the evils of Che Guevara and Fidel Castro, they're propping them up and making them look like visionaries, and obviously that is very problematic.
Thank you.
Yeah. And then you're not going to get rid of me that easily, because before we get some announcements from my colleagues, we have another special announcement from a good friend of Young America's Foundation. If you want to watch the screen, it should be...
Hey, folks, as you may know, I have not...
You can hear him, but you can't see him.
Ooh.
Basically all Kevin and I do at work every day is just figure out how to make Spencer's computer work.
Not been on campus at all this year, which stinks, because it's one of the best parts about my job. I'm making every effort to get back on tour soon, but until then, I'm really excited to have the opportunity to speak directly to all y'all again in a just-announced virtual event with Young America's Foundation, the first of its kind for conservative college students. The event, my first YAF speech since last year, will take place September 21st live on YAF's Facebook and YouTube pages. I'll be taking questions live from you. We can discuss everything from COVID to the election to race relations to dating, whatever you want. To make sure you get a notification when we go live, head over, subscribe to YAF TV on YouTube, or like the Young America's Foundation page on Facebook right now. The only way you get to participate in this interactive virtual event with me is through Young America's Foundation. So don't miss out. We'll see you there.
All righty. One more time for Spencer Brown. Just a few house cleaning items before Raj comes up and talks to you about the next thing that we will be doing, the shuttle schedule for tomorrow. Unfortunately,